to a meeting. We don't want to go to a meeting.
Where's
the hat?
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. Hi. Thank you for coming to our CRC keynote and the Curry lecture today. I'm going to have Bridget Hamry introduce our speaker.
Good morning, everyone. I thought that I could just get up and wing this, but then Leslie showed me the template and there's things I'm supposed to say, so I'll make sure to say them. So welcome here, and it's such an exciting day, and we have a really full house today, but we're really happy to have you attending the Curry Research Lecture Series. I'm Bridget Hamry. I'm a research associate professor here at Curry within the Center for Advanced Study of Teaching and Learning, and I'm just really pleased to be able to introduce my friend and colleague Elise Cappella. I just want to say a moment, take a moment to talk a little bit about this series. So this is sponsored primarily by the Virginia Education Science Training, or the VEST Pre-Doc Fellowship Program, which is supported by the U.S. Department of Education. The VEST program applies rigorous research methods and analytic techniques to social sciences in studying schooling and things that are happening in the classroom. It's really well suited to the work that Elise does. I did want to note that we are live streaming today, so welcome to those of you who are joining the live stream. And one just sort of technical note, if you have a question, which Elise will take sort of clarifying questions while she's speaking, and then we'll have time for questions after, just go ahead and raise your hand, and there's a few people with mics around the room who will bring you a mic so that we make sure that the people on the live stream can hear the questions. All right, so today, it really is my pleasure to welcome Elise Cappella. Elise is a clinical and community psychologist whose research integrates education and psychology with a goal of better understanding what disrupts and alternately promotes children's positive adaptation in schools and communities. Dr. Cappella has identified academic and social-emotional functioning among low-income children as priority areas of interest, and she particularly focuses on the social processes of schooling. Through numerous grants and partnerships, she'd studied many things. This is the part I thought, because I know her very well, I could ad-lib, and then I was reading her bio, and she's like, oh, really? She did that? And she did that? So there's a lot of things, and I've cut it all, so you don't have to worry that I'm going to stand here. But she's done really, really interesting things. So just to name a few, she's looked at sort of predictors of academic achievement among students at risk of failure, but then she's really been focusing on thinking about designing and testing interventions in that space. So, for example, she's designed and examined an intervention to enhance girls' social development and reduce relationally aggressive behavior. She's also worked with school and community partners to implement and study a mental health model focused on learning for disruptive children in high-poverty schools. Dr. Cappella was awarded an Early Career Research Award from the Society for the Study of School Psychology and a community collaborative grant from the Steinhardt School where she works. At New York University. She's worked to adapt and study a teacher consultation model, the My Teaching Partner model that was used here, that she sort of took and combined with the model she'd been working with at some colleagues at University of Illinois Chicago, and really was able to show an improvement in what was happening in the classroom using some of the natural resources within the school environment. More recently, Elise has become really interested in the methods and studying of peer relationships, which I know she'll get to talk about a little bit today. And just on a very personal note, Elise and I actually met as a part of a fellowship that was funded by the Department of Education, Institute of Education Sciences, a few years ago, 11, 12, 13, 14. And it was sort of a precursor to what now has become VEST, and there's actually a similar pre-doc training program at NYU where Elise is. And I just want to, you know, we met through that, and we've really continued a collaboration and partnership and friendship. So I think it's just a great example of how some of the early folks that you meet early on as you're, you know, visiting conferences, et cetera, can be really important to your career as you advance. So without further ado, I want to say that Elise, to read the last piece, that Elise will be talking for about an hour. As I said, if you have clarifying questions as she's speaking, feel free to raise your hand and we'll get a mic to you. And otherwise, we have plenty of time after that for questions. So thanks for joining us for this series today, and thanks for coming, Elise.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bridget. That was such a lovely introduction. Bridget is right. We met many years ago as part of a postdoctoral fellowship that was funded both by APA and also IES. And we are still collaborators and friends. And so look around you. These are the people that hopefully you will be working with for a very, very long time. Enjoy it. So what I'm hoping to do today is somewhat ambitious. We'll see if I can get through all of it. And again, feel free to ask questions of clarification as I go. I might go a little bit quickly at times, and I'm happy to slow it down. And hopefully we'll have a good 30 minutes or so at the end for sort of more substantive questions. So what I'm going to try to do today is first to convince you of the need for this approach of integrating mental health and academic learning in classrooms and school contexts, and particularly in doing so via natural resources and natural opportunities that already exist in these contexts. And I said this earlier to the best scholars that I had an opportunity to meet with, and I just want to say it here. I don't assume that this is the only approach to supporting kids' development, and there need to be many approaches being conducted simultaneously, things that I think a lot of you might be interested in already doing around economic and education policy, around pre-K quality education, around individual treatment approaches as well. And so this is one thing that we need to be focused on, but it certainly is not the only thing. And then I'm going to provide two examples. One is out of a team at the University of Illinois at Chicago, which is Links to Learning, and another is Bridge, of this effort. And these two examples are sustainable with existing school and community resources, so kind of this idea of natural opportunities, and have a dual focus, both on improving the classroom as a whole context for all kids in the space, and also on supporting the specific learning and development of kids with behavioral difficulties. I'm going to describe the effects that we found in the intervention trials that we conducted, and then I'm going to move to a piece at the end where I'm going to talk a little bit about other natural opportunities, and specifically, as Bridget mentioned, an interest in peers as resources for one another, the peer social context in the classroom. And I just want to say one more caveat before I begin, which is this is not about a particular approach. It's not about a curriculum or a codified project that can't be changed and shouldn't be changed. But it is really about how you build the resources and the capacity in schools and communities to create opportunities for both mental health and for learning in the natural spaces where kids live, work, and play. Okay. So to cut to the chase, the underlying premise of all of my work is that given where schools are at the juncture between families and communities, and given the amount of minutes every day that kids spend in schools, that schools have an inherent potential to promote children's development, broadly speaking. And I don't think I do think I'm preaching to the choir. I don't think I need to convince any of you that this is true. I also don't think I need to convince you that many schools struggle to realize this potential. And this is particularly true when they're facing a variety of stressors and strains due to socioeconomic disadvantage and other kinds of environmental stress. And there are multiple and complex barriers to doing so that I do not spend a lot of time on today, but I also don't want to diminish. And these are barriers across levels of the ecological context. And I'm going to let some of the teachers tell us a little bit about these. So these are teachers from our Chicago Public School study who were interviewed by my colleague Elise Chernoff. Here's a teacher who talks about neighborhood-level barriers to doing what she thinks is best practice in schools. And she says about her kids, once they go home, most of them pretty much are on lockdown. They're not allowed to go outside and play because in this neighborhood, it's very likely that you could get shot in your own front yard. And unfortunately, she wasn't exaggerating in this particular case in the south side of Chicago. Here's a teacher who says, I'm a stressed out mess because if I only had to focus on the teaching aspect of it, there's enough stress that goes with that. And as much as I try not to think about it and ignore it, I just can't. It's hard to do when the babies are walking in, you know, looking so hollow, looking hungry. This was a kindergarten teacher who was fairly new to the profession. Here's a teacher that talks about school-level disorganization, and she says, well, I mean, I don't know if you can hear it right now. They were in the school building, and I think it was during a transition period. She says, there's constant noise, there's constant chaos, there's no order whatsoever. There don't seem to be any school rules here. And here's a teacher who talks about both the classroom and kind of child level, and she says, over half my class has behavior issues, and it just depends on the day and who's in what mood and what happens the night before. And this is the level that I'm going to focus mainly on today. So why do we care about classrooms and kids, and why do we focus some of our energies and efforts in this space? So classrooms are the primary learning context for kids' education. They spend the majority of their day, especially elementary school kids, with one teacher and one set of peers in a classroom. And if you look at the literature on standardized achievement test scores, we find much bigger between classroom effects than we do between school effects. There's more variability within a school between classrooms in that school building than there is across schools on average. And that the quality of teaching practice, what's happening in the classroom between the teachers and the kids, the practices the teacher is using, matters. It contributes to kids' outcomes. And I say that knowing that a lot of my knowledge from this has actually come from the work of people here at UVA. At the child level, there are even larger between-child effects. So there's a lot of individual differences in terms of how kids develop over the course of time, and those are bigger than the between-classroom effects. If anybody has looked at their data recently and has conducted some analysis looking at the ICCs at the classroom level, at the school level, I imagine you've seen this as well. And finally, and particularly important for this work, is that behavioral challenges, so kids' early adjustment problems, are a primary reason for teachers to cite when they leave the profession, when they move into another field. And early adjustment problems I skip, but I want to just say this really quickly, unfortunately predict later child outcomes at a surprisingly and saddeningly robust rate. And then continuing down this path, in schools that serve a high proportion of students in poverty, so these are largely public schools in urban or poor rural areas, we tend to see, on average, less effective teaching practices, although there's certainly quite a bit of variability. And we see also, on average, more extensive and intensive academic and behavioral problems among the students there. Okay. And so here's a graph that'll be very familiar to Bridget. This is from about 11 years ago, a study that she published with Bob Pianta that showed that when kids who have these early adjustment problems, so when they start kindergarten with both behavioral and academic problems, if they find themselves in a classroom with an emotionally supportive first grade teacher, they end up by the end of the school year, of that first grade year, looking like their peers without early adjustment problems on standardized tests of achievement. So what this says to me, and I continue to rely on this because I think it's quite powerful, is that students with adjustment problems benefit from high-quality teaching practices across the classroom as a whole. So based on this work, and also based on many, many years of theory and other kinds of research, there's been a number of demonstration trials in the recent years, in the last 15 years or so, that have showed that teacher consultation, teacher coaching, teacher high-quality, salient in vivo teacher training can actually help teachers to use more effective practices and improve the classroom interactions in their classrooms in fairly high-poverty preschool and elementary school settings. And that's very exciting and very promising. But I want to argue that a lot of these models that have been shown in these demonstration trials have some areas that we can work on and improve upon. So one is that they tend to focus either, on the one hand, on teaching practices across the classroom as a whole, or on the other hand, on specific behavioral difficulties that one or two children are experiencing in that classroom, and tend not to integrate across these levels in a cohesive way. And second, they tend to rely quite heavily on external resources. So people outside the school building, outside the community, and also financial resources outside the school and the community in order to deliver these very intensive consultation and coaching models to teachers. And at the moment, I think that's quite important that we can show these positive effects with these external resources, but until we have the political will to actually provide those resources across all of these contexts, I think we also need to be thinking about natural resources within the spaces. And so that's what we were trying to do in some of this work, is incorporate existing school resources in intervention delivery to both improve the ability to sustain services over time and also enhance both classroom interactions and child outcomes. Okay, so who are these people? Who are these resources? At the moment, about 90% of schools across the nation in a fairly recent sampling have at least a part-time mental health person on staff at their school. And this is a social worker, a school counselor, sometimes a school psychologist, or much more rarely so, that provides school-based services to students. And these folks are really important resources. They have some knowledge and expertise that they come to the schools with. So they have knowledge and expertise in child mental health, assessment, individual treatment, sometimes some group therapy, sometimes some family outreach. They tend not to have very much training or experience or confidence in working with teachers in classrooms and in schools. And the traditional mental health services that they're providing certainly increase access to services for kids, but unfortunately, and on average, don't increase the effectiveness of those services. So kids who are experiencing mental health services in the context of a school building, at a health clinic, or with a provider there, they are showing up because they're in school, and so they're receiving services, but the outcomes of those services are no better than the outcomes of clinic-based services on average. So what we really wanted to do was to really think about how to reconceptualize school-based mental health to include support to teachers, include working with the primary adults in the primary context in which kids spend time in school, in order to improve the likelihood that teachers are using best practices of evidence-based practices to support behavior in learning for kids both with and without disruptive behavior problems. So we did so by pulling from two existing models, one an urban mental health model and one a teacher professional development model, which I will not talk at all about my teaching partner. This is something that you guys should know, or probably know, a huge amount about already. I will, however, talk about links to learning, and I will talk about Bridge. And so we're going to start with links to learning, which is this urban school mental health model that came out of about a decade of work by Mark Atkins, my colleague at the University of Illinois Chicago, and I had the opportunity to work very, very closely on this for about 4 years when I was in Chicago as well. So the aim of links to learning is to, as I mentioned earlier, reconfigure mental health services for kindergarten through fifth grade children who have disruptive behavior problems, which is the primary problem that teachers say gets in the way of their teaching, and that is primarily referred for mental health problems in urban schools. To focus on two things, to focus on the empirical predictors of learning as cogent mental health targets, which as in the education world does not sound radical at all, and in the mental health world is blows people's minds, that it's okay to focus on the predictors of learning and academic learning as an important mental health target. So that was the first thing. And the second was to focus on adaptive school functioning. So rather than simply focusing on alleviating symptoms, reducing symptoms of disorder, to actually try to promote adaptive school functioning as an important goal of mental health services. And the delivery of this model was by three primary resources that were natural resources in the south and the west sides of Chicago and really all over Chicago. Chicago is one of the 10% of districts that doesn't have regular mental health staff. So we were working in schools that had 1/6 of a social worker on staff, which is not enough. So the mental health service delivery model involved community mental health professionals. So people who were employed by community mental health agencies, of which there were a fair number, again, with a range of backgrounds in mental health. They operated under a fee-for-service model, which was they enrolled people on their caseloads, children in their clinics on their caseloads, and then they billed often Medicaid for the services that they provided to the children and the families. So this model was designed to be Medicaid billable services. We also worked with two sets of these natural resources, one of whom was also on staff at the community agencies, and these were parent advocates who came from the local community where the school was, where the kids were growing up, and they themselves had had a child who had been somewhere in the mental health system, either in special ed or in a clinic or someplace else. So they knew the system and they were also local, and they mostly were all high school graduates. Some had BAs, did not. So there were a range of backgrounds of these parent advocates. And then we also worked closely with leader teachers at each school, and I'll talk more about that in a second. And these second two sets of resources really were derived from thinking about diffusion of innovation and diffusion theory, Roger's work, and people who've done this work in global sort of healthcare initiatives really know that if you engage and have key opinion leaders in a given social network endorse the use of particular kinds of things, they can be health practices or education practices or something else, that it's more likely to diffuse through that network as opposed to someone who's more peripheral or who is an outsider coming in. So here's the links to learning model. You see the mental health providers, the community mental health providers are kind of the glue that holds it all together. The leader teachers and the parent advocates are providing support to the teachers and the parents on specific predictors of learning in that space. So for teachers, it was effective instruction, classroom management, and family outreach. And to parents, it was around communication, homework support, and reading development. And I'll say more about both of those in a second. And the idea was, via these sets of supports that were happening, that the classroom environment and the home environment would improve on the whole, and that these would impact on kids' school behavior, home behavior, and academic performance, or adaptive school functioning. Okay. So who are these leader teachers? I think this is a piece that is somewhat unique in the context of education settings, although increasingly is being used, if you've seen the work by Alan Daly and some of his colleagues around social network, teachers' social networks, increasingly has been being thought about at the level of teachers and education. So what we did is, in each of the schools who we were partnered with for this intervention trials, we asked each of the adults in the school building, all of the teachers, to name the teachers in their school from whom they might seek advice around those three predictors of academic learning: managing student behavior, involving families, and using effective instructional methods that are leveled and engaging. And then we also asked if there was anybody else in the school. We wanted to know whether they were going to people who were not classroom teachers. So it could have been an assistant principal or a parent advocate in the school building or somebody else. They were allowed to make unlimited nominations. And then we took all of their data and we put them into Excel 2x2 spreadsheets, and we used a program called USINET to analyze the data to determine the centrality of each individual teacher in the network as a whole and their closeness to other teachers, how many steps it took to get to other teachers. And we chose pairs in each school. So in each pair, we wanted them to have a certain amount of influence around all three of the areas that we were targeting in the intervention. So they had to be nominated across all three intervention areas. That was one criteria. The second is that the leader-teacher pair together had to reach every other teacher in the school building in the least number of steps possible. So we conducted some analysis called kind of geodesic coding. So we were trying to determine the number of steps it took for an individual teacher and then for the pair. We looked at a structural equivalence. We didn't want the two teachers to reach the same network and then have other teachers be left out of the network. And so here's an example of one of the schools. And the lighter green nodes are the two key opinion leader teachers that were chosen in that school. And the darker green nodes are the rest of the teachers in the school building. And you see from this that there could have been other teachers chosen. And in fact, in this school, if I recall correctly, there was another teacher chosen initially. We had chosen four, the top two who were the best choice. One of them retired within about a week of us choosing him, maybe because he was scared of being involved. But he was really, truly a master teacher. We loved him, and we were sorry to miss him. We found somebody else who fit the bill as well. Okay, so then what did they do? Because that's how we chose them. Then what did they have to do? We asked them to participate in an online course for some professional development credit to really learn the evidence-based strategies that fit those predictors of learning that they were going to be asked to help support teachers and endorse teachers' use of. They participated in that course with a paired community mental health professional. Also in that course, they had some face-to-face time and got to know each other via that. And then those two were asked to co-lead a 10-week professional development series for all of the teachers in their school building. And finally, they were not asked to be master teachers. So some of these teachers were not. And if you go and observe in their classrooms, they weren't necessarily using all of the kind of skills that you would want them to be using themselves. But they were very influential. And so what we asked them to do is to try them themselves and endorse their use. They didn't have to teach other teachers how to use them, but they had to endorse them, and they had to be enthusiastic about them. And I'm going to talk about the state strategies more when I talk about Bridge, so I'm going to kind of skip over that right now. So the home component, which I'm going to focus much less on today, I just want to briefly introduce. And on the left side, there's a lot of text that you're not expected to read. It was just a handout that we provided that I wanted to share with you. But basically, the parent advocates were working with parents in multifamily groups in the school building. And on average, those were difficult for parents to show up to. And so most of their work happened with parents. And what they did is they delivered a curriculum that was really focused on these three things, although one of them has been broken down a little bit because home routines came out as something that needed to be emphasized. So it's communication with their child about schooling, communication between them and their teacher about their child's schooling. Home routines that support learning, things like having a bedtime, having a space in the house, even if the house was a one-room apartment where there were five or six people living in that room. Where's that? Where's the corner where that child can go and sit in a chair and do their homework? So these kinds of routines that were kind of helping the families kind of think through what worked for them and how they could manage these. And then supporting homework completion and supporting reading development, even though a lot of these parents had very low levels of literacy themselves, kind of finding other ways to support reading development. And there are those ways. Okay. I know I've been speaking very quickly. I'm going to keep going unless I see a hand or a question of clarification. Okay. So we conducted a longitudinal field experiment. We did this over 3 years where they got about 2 years of intervention. And then we had 6 time points of data that were collected to each year, one in the fall and one in the spring. And all of this was Medicaid billable, so all of the work of the parent advocates and the work of the community mental health professionals was Medicaid billable work. The grant funded our supervision of them, but and the professional development credits, but nothing else. We randomly assigned schools to either the intervention, which is the links to learning, whole model, or a control condition. The control condition was that we were going to help these parents of children with disruptive behavior disorders get an initial appointment at a community mental health clinic for clinic-based services for the mental health problem that they were experiencing. And this was services as usual. We collaborated with 4 community mental health agencies in this trial. And we had 7 elementary schools that were randomly selected from a group that we pre-screened. So we screened all of the Chicago public schools for schools that were within a 2-mile radius of one of the 4 community agencies so that people who were in the control condition could actually get there. We wanted schools that were the highest need schools. We wanted the schools that had the most behavioral need and the most need for intervention support. Contrary to other folks who argued, work with schools that are already really well organized and functioning decently well so you can have an opportunity to make a difference. And we took the opposite approach for better or for worse. So we worked with schools that were greater than 85% kids who are eligible for free lunch, greater than 85% African American. This is in Chicago where the schools are very, very highly segregated, and there's many more African-American students. Now it's increasingly Latino, but when we first started the study, it was mostly African-American. And less than 30, then the kids who, and their reading test scores were below the 35th percentile. So these were really academically struggling schools. We enrolled 171 kindergarten through fifth grade students who had 1 or more disruptive behavior disorder. For people who don't know that kind of overarching term, this includes attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, oppositional defiant disorder, and conduct disorder. Conduct disorder was the lowest prevalence because that tends to increase as kids get older, and these were slightly younger kids, so it was mostly ADHD and ODD, and sometimes both simultaneously. The schools that we ended up in and the students we ended up with were almost entirely African American and eligible for free lunch. And I think what's important here is that eligible for free lunch is kind of a catch-all term for low income, but there's really different levels of low income. And so about 6 in 10 of our kids were from families that made below $10,000 a year, which I think is important in context for this too. We collected a whole bunch of data at each of the time points, although some of the data we weren't able to collect at the very end for a variety of grant cut reasons. We collected parent reports of child behavior, family stress, support and services, teacher reports of children's behavior, achievement in their own work life and their own organizational climate, classroom observations that were the ones that got cut at the end of the period with kids on and off task behavior and teaching practices. We gathered school records for grades, attendance. We did direct assessments with all of the kids. We used something called a curriculum-based measure, a curriculum CBM of reading skills. And then we collected a bunch of mixed method, qualitative and quantitative implementation fidelity data. To analyze the data, we used what are called mixed effects regression models, where kids were nested within classrooms primarily. And we also looked at both kind of year one pre-post models and across the three-year models for reasons particularly around the observations of kids' behaviors, where we were only observing kids by the end, and we couldn't observe all of the control kids by the end because of the grant funding. So we wanted to conduct some different kinds of modeling. So on average, this was implemented in an adequate way across about 2 years of intervention. So most teachers received a few classroom visits from the KOL and from the MFHP, as well as consultation meetings. This doesn't say this, but about 90% of the teachers completed the professional development series and made it to at least 9 out of 10. So that was actually quite good. So this is the more intensive coaching piece, and most teachers received something, not nearly as much as perhaps we would have liked. Most teachers also used one or more of the evidence-based practices, the daily report cards, the peer-assisted learning, or the good behavior game, and sometimes more than one for a duration that that was a meaningful duration. Most parents received some school or home-based services at least a few times across the 2 years. And again, you want to say, all right, the intensity is not huge here, and yet something's happening. And most children received individual treatment for the full study duration. So that's 52% of the kids. And let me just show you what that looks like. It means that, so that's what this is. So these are the links to learning kids. 52% of the kids received services for the full time, which is kind of unheard of. And as compared to only 16% of the services as usual kids. But this is what was really actually quite troubling to us. So as you heard me say early on, the services as usual, we said we were going to get all of these kids linked up to a community mental health agency that they could get to and have at least an initial appointment at that agency so that they could get services for their mental health diagnosis. And we did that only for 28% of the control kids. And that led to a number of conversations that we had as a research team about kind of the ethics of this. And we decided at some point in the trial to not continue enrolling new control kids because we couldn't do what it is that we thought was the very minimum that we should do given that they were participating in providing data and being observed and we were working talking to their families and their teachers, et cetera, that the minimum thing that we could do was get them linked up, and we weren't able to do that. So we have a mismatch, an imbalance in the numbers of people who were enrolled for the control versus the links to learning, and I think it's important methodologically to consider, but I also think it was important for me to mention. Okay, results. I'm just going to flash this up, and then I'm going to tell you about it. So we found significant positive effects on kids' observed behavioral engagement in classrooms. This is using something called the behavioral observation of students in schools, which is a time sampling approach where you're observing every 15 seconds for a period of 15 minutes over the course of a few days of instruction, kids' on and off task behavior and whether they're actively or passively engaged in that moment. And so we found that in the cross year, the 1 year kind of fall to spring, links to learning versus service as usual, that you see that this crossover is happening. So the services as usual kids were starting a little bit more engaged and going down, and the links to learning kids were starting much less engaged and going up. We would assume that this would continue across the course of the 3 years, but we don't know for sure, obviously. And then here's a second figure, which is the links to learning kids who have disruptive behavior disorders as compared to peer comparison kids in their classrooms, who may or may not have disruptive behavior disorders. So these are kids who are randomly chosen to observe in a classroom where the teacher is supposed to be using really good evidence-based practices, but the kid is getting more services, potentially, than the teacher. And so the links to learning kids, as compared to the peer comparisons, were doing better over the 3 years in terms of their behavioral engagement. We also found significant positive effect on academic as reported by teachers on the ACEs, Academic Competence Evaluation Scales, and on social skills reported by both teachers and parents on the SSRS. There were the strongest effects for the younger kids, the kindergarten through second graders, as compared to the third through fifth graders, and for kids who had less severe symptoms. And there were no effects on academic skills. We found no movement at all either direction for the for the kids in Links to Learning as compared to the SAU kids on curriculum-based measures of reading skills, and no effect on teaching practice in year one. Okay. So in sum, it's reasonably feasible to implement a fee-for-service school and a home-based mental health model that targets the predictors of learning. There's a whole bunch of that went into this that obviously I don't have time to talk about today, but I'm happy to answer questions about, and that we began to have a discussion about in the VEST meeting earlier, around this feasibility issue and around kind of creating opportunities for mental health professionals who are used to working in clinics to re-envision what their role was and to feel comfortable and confident in that role in schools and in homes. Importantly, we increased service initiation and retention for kids with disruptive behavior disorders. On average, about 80% of kids in urban communities do not get any services for their mental health needs. And so we obviously increased that quite a bit, not for the SAU kids, but for the kids in Links to Learning. We were able to make a difference in social skills, academic competence as reported by teachers, and academic engagement with magnified effects for certain groups, but there weren't effects on academic skills or on teaching practice. And it really led us to think about what we needed to do to increase the likelihood of effects in these areas. One is we thought we needed to enhance the classroom consultation and coaching, more intense component in the classrooms. And the other was that we needed to understand whether if we could enhance that, whether we would have improvements, not just for kids who were struggling with behavioral difficulties, but for other kids in the classroom. And particularly in urban schools where those kids may be kids with a variety of kinds of risks that we weren't capturing by these diagnoses that would potentially be on a slippery slope towards school disengagement over time. We wanted to be able to increase the likelihood that those kids could get the skills that they needed to continue on a positive trajectory. That brings me to the model, which is right here. And again, I'm skipping over this, but you'll see teacher consultation and coaching model focused in on the classroom component that's embedded within the regular activities of school-based mental health professionals, people who are already linked with schools. So here's how it's different from Links to Learning. It's focused on the school component, on classrooms, on kids with target students in those classrooms with behavioral difficulties. It uses the classroom assessment scoring system, as the common lens through which to conduct the consultation and coaching. So both teachers and mental health professionals get trained in this way of thinking and of viewing classrooms and of talking about classrooms. And it used what we called a classroom-focused continuous improvement cycle that enabled the school mental health professionals to work with teachers and individualize the intervention for each classroom. So the classroom assessment scoring system, usually you see three domains up here, right? There's the missing domain of instructional support. These were the two domains that were most relevant to school mental health practitioners' practice. And when we did our formative research to try to adapt MTP with Links to Learning to create this new model, we heard from school mental health professionals that there was no way that they were going to be able to support instructional support, because that just felt like a whole other world to them. So we said, all right, let's start with the two domains of practice and see if we can move from there. And these two domains, as many of you know really well, are broken down into different dimensions. So in emotional support, things like positive climate, teacher sensitivity and regard for student perspectives, and in classroom organization, productivity, behavior management, and ILF, instructional learning formats. And it's at this dimension level where the consultation and coaching took place. There's a bunch of indicators underneath those that everyone got trained in as well, but we really focused on the slightly broader dimension level, but slightly less broad domain level. And then here's the continuous improvement cycle. So if you know this world of quality improvement or of improvement science, continuous improvement is sort of an offshoot of these things. And it's the notion that you need to use data in making decisions. You need to reflect on that data and then implement some strategy to try to move that data toward a target. And you need to continue to do that over time so that it's not just a one-shot deal, but it happens over and over again. And this is what we wanted to happen in classrooms. We wanted the initial assessment, which was a classroom observation professional conducted as part of their regular work in schools, that focused both on the classroom as a whole and on the individual or multiple individual target students. They use the class lens for the classroom side of their observation. And they use what's called functional behavioral analysis as a lens for their focus on individual student behaviors. And what FBA does is it allows you to kind of understand the behaviors that might interfere with learning and then what circumstances are maintaining that behavior. And so they actually linked quite well. The mental health professionals are much more familiar with the FBA than they are with the class, and so we provided much more training on the class. And then the second step is reflection. It's where they meet with the teacher for about 25 minutes on average to discuss the observation that they conducted, some of the things that went really well, some of the positive things that they saw, and some of the things that they could work on. And the observation was focused both on teaching practice as a whole, as well as on specific teaching practice with the kids that these teachers were struggling the most with. And together, the mental health provider and the teacher then, who were really using the class lens and focusing on one dimension, one kind of focal dimension initially, would then choose an evidence-based strategy or two from what we call the tips and tools manual that the teacher would then implement in the third step, which is the action step, with coaching support from the mental health professional as needed. So what are these evidence-based strategies that I hinted about and links to learning and that I'm now going to talk a little bit more about here? So these, again, I did not make these up. So these came from both the links to learning and my teaching partner, and then also from a really thorough combing of both the education and psychology literatures on what are some kind of kernels, behavioral kernels in particular, but other kinds of very small strategies that have shown in repeated trials to have positive effects on kids' social emotional learning and on their academic learning. And then we linked those evidence-based kernels directly back to the dimensions of the class on the left side. We used theory to do this mainly because most people did not use the class to test these things. So the good behavior game, for example, is a fairly simple and quite widely used strategy for teachers to calm down the classroom and increase the likelihood of rule following during specific periods of time. So during an activity, during a transition, it's been used globally. It's been used in lunchrooms and hallways as well as in classrooms. And we provided some training to the mental health professionals so they knew how to support a teacher in using this to meet the needs of their classroom. A self-monitoring approach or is something that has been shown particularly in school psychology literature, where you work with an individual kid to help them reflect, self-reflect on their own behaviors and be aware of their own behaviors and rate them. And so this is what a self-monitoring card could look like for this particular kid. These are the rules that they were going to try to follow. And initially, both the mental health provider and the child, or the teacher and the child, completing this for one 20-minute period, one 40-minute period. Over the course of about 2 weeks, even kindergarten-age kids begin to see their behaviors more accurately, begin to rate themselves more accurately. And you can link this to small positive rewards or simply praise. Good news notes or daily report cards are around increasing the likelihood that kids are going to use positive behaviors and families are going to be involved, and they can look something like this. And then these kinds of strategies are more from the education literature, so people who know that world will be fairly familiar with this. The mental health professionals were much less familiar with things like peer-assisted learning or advanced organizers, and required a little bit more support to train the teachers and use and how to use them, but the teachers actually felt more comfortable with them. And so here's the whole thing, and this shows you that there's some training at the top for the mental health staff and for the teachers. There's an initial interview or interaction or conversation that happens between the mental health professional who's already paired with that school and the teachers with whom they're going to work, and then they're supposed to be doing this continuous improvement cycle about monthly over the intervention. Okay, and then here's the logic model for the actual pilot study that we did. We did this, I had then moved to New York, so we did this in the New York City public schools, mostly in Washington Heights and Harlem. So there are a lot of differences with the New York City School District and the Chicago Public School District that I'm not going to go into, but certainly was very different on the ground in a lot of ways. But there are also some similarities, so I'll talk a little bit about those. We spent about a year first trying to refine Bridge in context, and this was the phase one research. And then we spent the next year doing a classroom-level randomized design of bridge versus training only. We collected mixed method implementation data and outcome data, and I will talk about that right now. So we partnered with one community agency because the schools did have much more mental health support in New York City than in Chicago, people on staff in the school, but we also really wanted to work with this community agency who was linked with these schools, and their school mental health providers were already in these schools. As you see from this, our population, our sample, was ethnically different than in Links to Learning. We had predominantly Latino kids. It was more, less high poverty, so even though 94 and the 90% of the kids were eligible for free lunch, it wasn't at the levels of extreme poverty that we saw in the Chicago schools. And achievement test scores were not good for the New York City schools, but not as poor, not as struggling schools as the Chicago schools. And this is just to show you the participant flowchart. So we randomized 36 to either the full bridge model or the training for all teachers and all mental health providers, but no follow-up consultation and coaching. And then we followed kids pre-post across the course of one school year. And then a lot of measures, we collected observations of emotional support and classroom organization via class. We collected student-teacher relationship data from teachers, peer report data, organization and aggression, behavioral regulation data from teachers and kids' reports of their own academic competence, their sense of themselves as learners who are excited to learn and are prepared for the academic learning that takes place. Okay, are we all still together? Any questions? Sure? All right. So, super quickly, dosage. we conducted intent to treat analyses where we kind of took advantage of this classroom randomization, kids within classrooms, a bunch of covariates at classroom and kid levels, although we dropped a bunch of them that weren't needed for reasons of parsimony. And I want to just give you the outcomes. So we found in three of the six child level outcomes that we tested impacts in the right direction for assignment to bridge, so impacts on teacher-student closeness, on peer victimization, and on academic self-concept or competence as reported by kids themselves. We did not find impact on teachers' report of teacher-student conflict, aggressive behavior, or behavioral regulation. And what's important here is that this is on all kids who were content-centered in the classroom, kids with and without behavioral difficulties. The effects were magnified for kids with behavioral difficulties, as one would expect. No main effects at the classroom level. However, for teachers who had low levels of emotional support at the start of the year, if they were randomly assigned to full intervention, bridge intervention, as opposed to simple training, they improved their emotional support by the end of the year, as compared to teachers who had low emotional support at the beginning of the year, who were randomly assigned to the control condition. In sum, we think that this model is reasonably feasible, so that school-based mental health staff who are partnered with schools or already working in schools can embed this work into their regular treatment that they're doing, their regular assessment that they're doing, their regular outreach that they're doing, about monthly going through this continuous improvement cycle with a sample of consultant mental health professional had about four teachers per person. And it can enhance classroom support for teachers who are struggling at the beginning of the year with that, and child psychosocial outcomes. So there's a lot of questions that remain. One is, are there long-term effects? This is pre-post, one school year. Two, are there effects on the outcomes that we didn't see effects on if we were to do something different? Something else that we could have done, we should have done to have effects on these other outcomes of importance? And this brings me to this last part of the talk, and I promise you I will get you out done so that there's time for questions. But I want to spend a little time on this last part of the talk talking about the class. Thing that we didn't focus on is we didn't focus on the classroom peer context, and we observed in this study and also in other research that I've done that particularly as kids grow through middle childhood and begin the process of entering early adolescence that their peers become increasingly important to them, increasingly salient. And we think that this is another potential natural opportunity and resource for kids in school context that could be harnessed, could be activated to try to support what the teacher and the school is doing. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about some basic research that we did stemming from this project, but a tiny bit of background. So here's how, for many years, developmental and educational scientists really thought classrooms work. That what the teacher brings to the classroom, what the child brings to the classroom, those are the things that matter to how the child is going to function in that classroom and their outcomes over time. And in the last couple of decades, we've really focused on the fact that there's not just these two factors, but there's this third, and obviously you could probably come up with another 100 factors that are important. But the third one that I want to focus on today is on peers and peer social context. So that what the teacher brings is important, what the child brings is important, but how the peers are interacting as a whole and the dynamics of that whole social context are also going to play into what the teacher does, what the child does, and how the child functions over time. And we know with a good amount of certainty now that individual peer relationships matter to kids. So a kid who has a friend where they say that person's their friend, that person also says that they're friends, when the kid is reasonably accepted by their peers, and when a kid is integrated into the peer network and not completely isolated, that kid tends to do okay. However, there's theory and research outside of schools and classrooms, increasingly within schools and classrooms, that suggests that it's not just the individual relationships that matter, that it's also the structure and the pattern of those relationships that matter. So peer social norms theory and peer network, social network theory, and even social capital theory to a certain extent suggests that social structures facilitate or constrain behavior. And that regardless of any individual relationship in a space, that the structure, the social structure, the second bullet point here is that resources flow through a social network, not just between a dyad, so across the entire setting. And so we wanted to test some of these theories in the context of the intervention that I just showed you. And so one of the things that I mentioned to the best students earlier on is that no matter what I'm studying, I'm always collecting a little extra data to ask and answer some basic scientific questions that I think will be valuable for the next iteration of whatever intervention that I'm trying to study. And so in this case, we collected some social network data from this group. And we had three primary questions that we wanted to ask and answer. One was, does the classroom structure predict students' behavioral engagement over 1 year? Behavioral engagement is, again, an observed measure of kids' active engagement in classrooms. So they're raising their hand, they're participating, they're writing when they're told to write, they're reading when they're told to read. And doing other things. Two, does this association between the classroom social structure on the one hand and behavioral engagement over time on the other vary by the quality of the teaching? And third, does the association vary by child level or behavioral? And so we use the data set plus this additional social network data that we collected just for the second to fifth grade classrooms because it's very, very difficult to collect reliable social network data from 5 and 6 year olds. We also used, I'm friends with everybody, so it's, I hate them all, right? So it's very difficult. So we also used the observed measure of teaching practice, the class, observed measure of behavioral engagement, some peer reports and teacher reports on some of these other things as well. We did multi-level modeling, children in classrooms, controlling intervention condition, which was very important, and child and level covariates. And now I want to just go to the side because maybe some of you are wondering what is this term, social network equity. Based on other theory that's out there, we thought about what kind of social structure might be most beneficial for kids in a classroom environment. And we came to this place where we thought, you know what, kids need to be connected to one another because learning happens within the context of relationships. And if you have a classroom where nobody is connected to anybody else, then basically it's like individual tutoring without the benefit of the individual. So we thought there needed to be be somewhat dense social connections. But we've also seen classrooms where there's decently dense social connections, but only in a particular group. And so some kids have all the friends, and other kids have none of the friends. And particularly for kids for whom I care about, kids who are kind of on a spectrum of strength and need, who may have some real difficulties, may not necessarily have a lot of connections, it is really important to think about the extent to which the connections are equitably distributed across the classroom. And so we came up with this term, social network equity. We should hire a marketer to come up with it. Terrible term. But it does describe what it is, that many social ties dispersed widely across students in the classroom. And it's really a fairly simple calculation. You take the Freeman's degree centrality, which is a really common, it's a way of just how many kids an individual kid is connected to in the classroom, divided by how many kids they could be connected to in the classroom. And we then created a mean of that for every classroom in our sample. And we divided the standard deviation by mean, and we multiplied that by 1, so that higher amounts could mean more equity versus having to wrap your head around higher amounts being less equity. Okay, so here's two snapshots of two different classrooms. And just to kind of walk you through each of the little rectangles. Oh, I have 30 minutes? No. Okay, thank you. Each of the little rectangles, the filled in rectangles are the boys, the unfilled rectangles are the girls, the lines between them. So what we do is we aggregate all of the social network data across all the peer reports in a given classroom. We do a calculation in a program called USINET so that we can predict whether a connection is really a connection or it's really random chance that these two people are linked. And then we make the lines that as an aggregate of all the kids' understanding of the classroom social relationships. So the classroom on both sides are pretty gender split. There's some methodological reasons for that, so some developmental reasons for that. The classroom on the right, people often miss it, but there's about 7 kids on the upper right side, upper left side of the right side of the screen. Oh, here, I can point to it. Okay, so these are just descriptive, these two classrooms that I wanted to just show you, and I chose them for particular reasons, right? I chose them because this classroom on the left, which has many connections among many kids in the classroom, is both a highly dense, above a standard deviation above the mean classroom, as well as a highly equitable classroom. And the classroom on the right is both a low dense and a low density and a low equity classroom. Although you can tell the girls are pretty dense. But the girls are only half of the class, right? And behavioral difficulties, unfortunately, are more common and more commonly recognized among boys. Okay, and then just the other thing that we began to see descriptively in some of our data is that this tended to be correlated in small, but we think potentially meaningful ways with teaching practice. So the classroom on the left had high levels of emotional support and organization, the classroom on the right, not so much. Okay, so we found a main effect of social network equity on behavioral engagement across 1 year. I'm gonna just keep going because I have no time. We found a moderated effect of social network equity on engagement by classroom organization. So let me quickly describe this. This means that for students who were in classrooms that had high levels of social network equity and high levels of classroom organization, they were engaged 85% of the time in observations of their behavioral engagement by the end of the year, controlling for early behavioral engagement and a bunch of other things, as compared to classrooms, kids who had high levels of social network equity, low levels of social network equity or low levels of. Third, there's a moderate effect of social network equity on students' behavioral difficulties. So for kids who had behavioral difficulties, if they were in a classroom with high levels of social network equity, they looked exactly like kids who didn't have behavioral difficulties in terms of their engagement. This is not a causal model, but I think this is important and interesting to talk about. And so what we think this says is that the classroom context matters, that we need to be thinking about it also not just at an individual level, but at a contextual level. Potentially, classroom interventions that target both teaching practices and the classroom social context for learning might be the most promising. Which brings me very quickly to a couple of next steps. So what we're beginning to do now is study a model of teacher coaching that tries to do a little bit of this in a very naturalistic way. There's a lot of research on peer-assisted learning techniques that has shown that peer-assisted learning is very effective, especially for younger students, for both academic achievement and social-emotional outcomes. But it's very, very hard to implement. And so we're beginning to study a model of coaching teachers to do this, because this could be a better way to promote better peer in classrooms. This is a model of kind of what we've focused on in the past, universal and targeted kids, and the Links to Learning project. We focused on intensive kids as well, kids with more severe difficulties. And so we're beginning to do this linking across all three levels, we think, a little bit better by thinking about intensive interventions in self-contained classrooms. We lost the family component when we came to New York and we focused in on the classrooms, and so we're beginning to reintegrate that into the work because we think it's really critical. And then finally, from all of our post-implementation focus groups with teachers and with mental health professionals, what we see as one of the biggest barriers as well is having system level. So we're beginning to do this in a couple of ways. We're getting teachers to use an electronic dashboard to begin to monitor their own use of the continuous improvement cycle and decide what strategies they want to use. And two, by embedding this into a district-wide implementation approach with teachers, again, going back to the Links to Learning model, thinking about leader-teacher partnering. And so here's the model as a whole, which has yet to be tested, but grant is pending. So finally, this is not easy or simple, as you might imagine, and many of you probably have a lot of experience doing this yourself, and so you know it from your own hands-on experience. We can move kids and move classrooms in small ways, small effect sizes, sometimes moderate, and we cheer when we do. But I'd like to think of a metaphor that came to me years ago, that if you were to take a ship that was traveling from one side of the world to the other, and you were to change their direction by 1 degree, they would end up in a completely different space than they originally had planned to. So my argument for continuing, my motivation for continuing when I see small effects can have large impacts over time, and that is the hope and the goal. And there's been some research to show that in other studies. My research has not been longitudinal enough to show that. But we need to begin to integrate across these levels. And in the beginning, I talked about barriers across levels and the work that all of you hopefully are doing in other spaces. We need to begin to think about these things as cohesive and not as these kind of separate initiatives and separate projects and packages. And we need to begin to think about how to infuse these approaches that I talked about, in daily contexts where kids live and work. Study it with rigorous and responsive research. The ethical issue I brought up for this. And the goal of mine, and I imagine the goal of many of yours as well, is not only to contribute to science, I mean, I think that's very, very important, but also to contribute to the likelihood that we find ways of promoting school success and beyond school success for more kids in need. And so I'm going to end by saying that this does take a village and sometimes a city, a town, and a whole country. It takes some funding to do it. Thank the funders. These are just a handful of collaborators. There were huge numbers on the screen. The participants, the deliverers of these models, the people in the communities who we talked with for years. Also, and thank you for your time. Questions or comments, both are welcome.
Hi, Elise, thank you very much for that. You know, it's important work you're doing, and I really appreciate it. This is actually something that isn't directly related to that work, but I'm hoping you can speak about. You pointed in the end to systemic, support for this, and I'm wondering, work of Hoy, around enabling school structure, and Bryke around relational trust points to the importance of school organization and school effects. I'm wondering what you might just be thinking about in terms of school effects of diffusion in particular, and Links to Learning and any implications for Bridge as well.
Good. Thank you. This question always comes up. It's a really, really important question. And we deliberately went in and links to learning at the level, we wanted the endorsement from the principal, but we didn't really care about anything else. We went in at the level of classrooms. And we did it because of the research on classrooms being really the place where the learning is taking place, and we need to focus. But then for 3 years there, and for 2 years in Bridge, we heard from the teachers over and over again that the school context was really critical. And we knew that from, obviously, the work of the people that you've mentioned. In terms of kind of broader diffusion, I mean, I just want to say two things. One is, I don't think we yet have a, we do one of two things. We either go into schools that are already well-organized and try to do something, right? Or we go into schools that are less well-organized and ignore the organization. And there are models, people, so Catherine Bradshaw, I know with PBIS, has done this, where they've really tried to create sort of school-level change as part of PBIS. I don't think we have great research yet on how to shift the organizational culture and climate in schools. And I think increasingly we need to be turning to sort of workforce development outside of the school literature and outside of the teaching workforce, around sort of in healthcare fields, in business fields, in other fields where they've actually done a fair number of organizational interventions that have been reasonably successful, that we can potentially draw from. Knowing that schools are different beasts, knowing that teachers, even though their colleagues are other teachers, that really their colleagues on a day-to-day basis are those children. Who are they seeing mostly? Is they're seeing other kids, and there's a lot of isolation. But thinking about, so thinking about keeping that hat on, but relying on other literature. So Charles Glisson has some really good work in healthcare that he's done. He has an organizational level intervention that we really worked with him around trying to translate for schools and haven't quite gotten there yet to do so. Stacey Fraser has done some work where she's used his measures of psychological climate and organizational climate with teachers and adapted it for kids. So we have some data on their usefulness. I don't have a great answer for you, but I think it's a really important direction. Yep. Yeah.
I have a question about the social network equity that you brought up. So you were saying that when a classroom has higher social network equity, the students with behavioral problems behave as though they don't, or that their performance is as though they don't. And I was wondering how you thought the equity was achieved, whether it was just dependent on teacher practices, because I'm imagining certain behavioral problems where the students exhibit antagonistic behavior, and whether other peers would be willing to, you know, to integrate more with students like that, even if the teacher orchestrated that kind of climate where they would be more integrated? Mm-hmm.
So it's a really good question. We don't know why some classrooms had higher levels of equity than other classrooms. We imagine it's something about the composition of the kids, something about what the teacher is doing, and some unknowns that we don't even know how to kind of think about yet. And you're absolutely right. So in classrooms where there may be kids with really extreme behavioral difficulties, maybe regardless of what the teacher is doing, it may be hard to kind of incorporate that child. And I'm not suggesting that in every classroom, everyone has to be friends with everyone. And I have young children, and I never told them that you don't have to be friends with everyone, but you have to respect everyone in the classroom, and you have to learn how to work with everyone in the classroom. And so there's this kind of difference there. So I showed you a picture of a classroom where everyone had at least one friend. A classroom could have reasonable levels of social network equity where there were kids with, you know, certainly a range of friendships in that classroom. But I think this question is one that's really interesting. I've been increasingly interested, and maybe this doesn't quite answer your question, but I've been increasingly interested in understanding which interventions that may work with teachers or principals or other people in a school building produce change in the social context, right? Rather than simply produce change in individuals. So we often look at change in the social context via teaching practice or via adult relationships or other things. But if we assume that our our knowledge of child development is good, and by early adolescence, that social context is at least as important as anything that any teacher is going to do in a classroom or a school, then we need to be thinking about ways that are realistic, that are non sort of puppetry, where I'm going to tell you who to be friends with, that enable kids to be friends across groups, to be friends with other kids who they may not choose to be friends with initially, but realize that they have something that's the work increasingly that I'm interested in doing. And there's people, I had this lovely conversation this morning where we were talking about kind of exposure to kids who are different from oneself, and then the likelihood of then creating context within that exposure to increase not just contact, but high quality contact and potentially even friendship, I think is important. I don't think I fully answered your question, but. I was just told we have 15 minutes, so.
I also have a question.
Sure.
I didn't hear you talk at all about medication, and I was wondering, at least in my experience working in similar schools and with students with similar behavioral diagnoses, medication, like a lot of times very strong dosages, was kind of the go-to for a lot of the community-based mental health organizations. And so I just wondered, it seems like that could be some sort of confounding variable in how you guys thought about that.
Mm-hmm. So if you think about it, though, what we were really doing is we were saying, do your business as usual. Do your individual treatment, do your family organization planning, outreach, support services, do your med management, if that's what you would do, and then also do this. So that's, in some senses, kind of controlled for in a lot of ways, right? Because in both control condition and intervention condition, they were doing their individual services as usual. Now you might say, well, you're asking them to do something extra, so that does not take the place of something that they were already doing. And what I would argue back, at least for Bridge, is that they weren't actually taking a lot of extra time to do it, because often they were going into classrooms and observing, but they weren't really taking any notes, and they weren't really supporting the teacher, and they weren't really having a model for how to do it in any. So what we were saying is, you already are going into classrooms every now and again, and you're already talking to the teacher in the hallway. Well, let's find a good framework, a theoretically based and empirically based framework for you to do this well, so that work is better, right, than it currently is, and that you can focus on it more. And what we found on average in the Links to Learning project, so in our Bridge project, not very many kids were medicated in either condition, and there were really no differences. And Links to Learning, many more were medicated because they were operating in sort of more the traditional services. And again, our control kids weren't getting services, so our intervention kids were getting services, so that is an important difference to kind of consider. But the control kids who were getting services, and the small numbers that were not doing well, unfortunately. And that was also part of what kind of sort of broke our heart about actually having to see that firsthand.
I was wondering about the implication of these results for the training of a school psychologists or mental health professionals that I used to be trained more with an individual focus. So if you have any thoughts around that?
Sure. What's your name again, Pilar? Pilar was asking whether what the implications of the results of this were for pre-service training of school psychologists or mental health professionals, or social workers or counselors, certificate kinds of programs. I think there's huge implications, actually. Not necessarily for this specific research, but for all of what we know about. If you're going to work with kids in the context of a school, the best thing is not to simply take your clinic-based model and set it into the school, which is what we've been doing for years and years. So you take a health clinic, you put it in the school, you pull kids out of their primary learning environment, you pull them out of the classroom, and you do whatever you do for a 50-minute hour, and then you send them back into the classroom. And we know for behavioral difficulties that that's not. So I would argue that it really should be shifting our approach entirely. And thinking about meeting kids where they are for services, and that's in after-school programs and other kind of community-based organizations, as well as schools, preschools. And preschools, I think, are a little bit more cutting edge on this in some senses. People in the world, in this room, who do preschool education might not use the word cutting edge for a lot of their preschools that they're spending time in. But in terms of thinking about the child as a whole child and thinking about services, I mean, Head Start to health services, to families and education services and multi-generation education models where parents are getting to go back to school in part through connections that they've made through their preschool, et cetera. So I think actually they're a little ahead of the K-12 education in this. But absolutely, I would, and increasingly I'm interested in working at my university level around doing this.
Hi, I'm curious about the mental health professionals' sort of response to this intervention and what you learned from their perspective about how they felt about it and what challenges they faced in implementation. My sister's a school psychologist, so coming at it from that lens, It sounds like something she would really be engaged by.
Yeah, so we had a full range from people who said it didn't really fit into their way of working or how they ever thought that they would be doing with their time, people who wanted to do it exclusively, and then people on the other end of the continuum who just said, this is desperately in need of this. I've been making this up as I've been going, and I don't really know what I'm doing, but this is where it's going to be. So we had the whole range. I think kind of the mid of that range was a teacher who said to me, you know, when you start talking about these dimensions, I'm like, what are these dimensions? And she's like, and then like I started to like get it, and I started to own it, and I started to use it, and I felt like it helped. So like it's that kind of, you know, so our goal here was kind of incremental change. It was not let's, you know, flip everybody over and have them walk on their hands. It was, all right, let's have you walk a little bit differently than you normally walk and see what happens. And hopefully you'll get some small results, and that will increase the likelihood that you'll continue to do this. And we wanted that for the teacher as well. Try this strategy for a week with the whole class in math. And at the end of the week, let's revisit it. And then let's, if we need to shift it a little bit, try it for another week with this shift, with this ad, and see what happens. And this, the little Excel spreadsheet that I showed you at the very end, which is this kind of way of teachers to monitor themselves, has helped teachers to begin to see, oh yeah, the kid did not run from my classroom three times today. He only ran twice. That's good, right? That's a start.
So I had a question around really thinking about the correlation between quality of classroom practice and the social equity among peers. And thinking about how, in my observations in classrooms, how teachers' relatively low frequency and I think unintentional responses to children who display challenging behaviors really facilitates an isolated peer in ways that I don't think they intend in some ways. You know, some ways are very obvious, like when they put a kid's name up on a board. But in some ways, it's not obvious, and I don't think it's intentional, and I don't think it's something the teacher notices, and I don't think it happens that frequently. So I was just wondering if you kind of thought about what are the ways that you could actually change teacher practice to kind of increase that social equity for those kids, like those kids that are isolated, that I'm like, I feel like I know who those kids are. And that I don't think teachers know that they're doing that.
So this actually came, this idea originally came from thinking about the work of Rona Weinstein and then Amori Makami, who used to be here at UVA, who have thought about teacher expectations and differential treatment of kids, basically. And Rona Weinstein's work was really around differential treatment of kids around academic expectations. And Amori really took it into the space of social relationships. And she did an intervention, I believe, with teachers to try to increase the likelihood that they could recognize some of these sort of, I mean, kind of micro interactions that they were having that signaled to kids who was in and who was not, right? And had some success with that intervention. I'm not gonna speak on this with a lot of knowledge because I haven't done that myself. But I do think that that is a really, really important direction. So, you know, I think these are very global. These are, you know, we're trying to increase classroom quality in emotional support and classroom organization and kid outcomes that are pretty vast, right? It's not really targeted. But I do think each of these pieces are really important pieces, and I would love to think more about how to incorporate that. Oh, this side. I'm gonna start walking over here. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm really interested in the social network equity stuff that you're presenting, and I was wondering first what time of year you collected that data and whether you think social network equity changes at all across a year in a classroom, because all these kids are sort of shuffled in between different classrooms and different combinations as they move up each grade level, right? And whether that might have implications for sort of systematically how we form classrooms as kids get older and change grades.
That's really interesting, yes. We only collected the social network data in the spring. In the fall. We only collected the social network data in the fall. The reason we didn't collect it in the spring was because we were collecting the data pretty late, and we just couldn't get through all of our data collection, and it was this add-on, right, it was the supplemental piece, so we just kind of let it go. So I haven't really thought about the moving across grades. Tom Kinderman has done some really interesting work where he's in a small community, and so everybody knows everybody, and then there's these different combinations in each year, but everybody still knows everybody. So he's been able to track this across time in a way that's much harder in these more high mobility schools that I'm in. So in these schools, specifically in the Chicago schools, kids were coming and going in ways that were really surprising to me, actually. It's not the same cohort every year. But you're right, there are spaces where there is the same cohort every year, and it would be super interesting to see, given that same cohort with a different teacher, right? Same cohort of kids, and actually there's some countries where they do that, where they really, the same cohort of kids move from teacher to teacher in a middle school setting and another setting, and to really look at the extent to which these social relationships, the social ties, depend on the teacher or not, right? Or depend on kind of time. And other kinds of things. I haven't done that. It's really intensive data to collect, and not very many people, unfortunately, collect it. And when they do, they often collect it in ways that I don't trust that much. So the Ad Health data set's a great data set if you ever want to look at social network data, but they didn't have unlimited nominations, so it means that these adolescents who might have more than five friends can't really report it, and I just don't entirely believe necessarily that the social groups that they're coming up.
Just to follow up on that last question, any of the classrooms that you collected social network data from, were they all self-contained classrooms, or were any of them, you know, classrooms like third, fourth, or fifth grade, sometimes those students are rotating and, you know, transitioning from math or science. So the data you collected, was it entirely self-contained classrooms, or was it from any students who were in, you know, co-teaching situations?
They were, all classrooms were eligible. So in New York, so we collected social network data also in Chicago, and it was the same. In New York, there were regular ed classrooms, integrated co-taught classrooms, and self-contained classrooms that were like 12 one-on-one classrooms. But the kids didn't move then between those. So once they were assigned one in the beginning of the year, that was their classroom. Is that what you're suggesting? I think there was one classroom that had two grades, and that was it. It was almost all entirely within grade. Help me understand your question.
Yeah, I was just thinking about, like, I'm a teacher, and I teach math and social studies, and so my kids move to a different teacher for reading, and then they move to a different teacher for science, and so that group of students stays together. So those situations where, you know, sometimes in the upper grade levels, the students will have different teachers for different subjects, I guess. You know, some fifth grades, you have a self-contained classroom where one teacher does all the instruction. We have certainly, you know, EC students and all those students in our classrooms, but that group of students moves around, and I didn't know if you collected any data on classrooms
they didn't move.
Like that.
No, one teacher taught it all, except for Jim.
We have time for one last question.
On that side of the room. There you go. But you have to wait till you get to the, there you go.
So the two interventions you were mentioning you did with K through 5 students, do you have a sense if you think those types of interventions would work in a secondary setting? And if they did, what constructs might be more or less important?
So I think the specific evidence-based strategies would be different, right? Self-management, self-monitoring is actually not that. You can still use that all the way up till eighth grade. The good behavior game, you wouldn't want to call it that. And actually, with the fifth graders, they never call it that to the kids.
Right.
So the specific strategies we need to kind of tailor. But the as you know, the class goes all the way up. There's the indicators look a little bit different. Some of the dimensions look a little bit different. So I think the general kind of the key ingredient, I would say, these classroom continuous improvement cycles, this idea of assessment using the class and some sort of functional behavioral analysis, plus the reflection, plus the action, that can be at any level. The actions are going to shift. And the mental health professional, unfortunately, as they get the kids get older, often becomes really only the guidance counselor. And that guidance counselor is really focused on academic learning, and so that's where you really need to be kind of thinking about pulling in other people, the leader teachers in particular, but other other folks in the community who can kind of participate in upward extension for one district, and so we're going to try to get some money to try to do that.
All right, well, I just want to take a moment to thank Elise and thank all of you.